It's great to be here to discuss the STS-132 launch countdown status. Before I get into that, I just want to commend all the teams that support the space shuttle program here at Kennedy Space Center, across the country, and around the world. You know, these teams have done an outstanding job getting Atlantis, the external tank, our solid rocket boosters, our payload, and all our ground facilities ready to support the STS-132 launch and mission. We've had a very clean countdown so far, and we're currently on schedule, and we're not working any issues. The clock is currently holding at T-minus 11 hours, and that's a planned built-in 13-hour and 55-minute hold. Last night, we completed the loading of our onboard cryogenic reactants for our fuel cells. We currently have 4 days of LH2 and 11 days of LO2 pad hold time. There are several operations in work at the pad this morning. Teams are busy retracting access platforms and configuring the pad for launch. The checkout of our orbiter and ground communications network is planned for 11:30 this morning. At 5:30 p.m., the rotating service structure will be retracted and we'll continue doing our final closeouts for launch. At 7 p.m., we'll perform our ascent switch list. And just before 10 p.m., the countdown clock will resume counting at T-minus 11 hours. We'll then begin our final external tank loading preparations and start clearing the pad just before midnight. Our shuttle managers will meet at 4:15 a.m. tomorrow morning for our tanking weather briefing set up prior to our external tank load. Hopefully Todd will give us some good news about the weather, and we'll proceed with external tank loading at 4:55 a.m. Flight crew will arrive at the pad and begin their ingress to the vehicle at 11 a.m. Our launch window for tomorrow is approximately 10 minutes in length and will open at 2:15 p.m. And we typically target the middle of the window, which correlates to just after 2:20 p.m. As far as our mission goes, it's a 12-day mission, 0 contingency days, and 2 weather contingency days. And our end of mission landing is planned for KSC at 8:44 a.m. on Wednesday, May 26th. As far as our scrub turnaround plans go, we have enough onboard fuel cell reactants to get 4 launch attempts in 5 days, and that's using our standard 24 and 48-hour scrub turnaround options. We do have launch opportunities through May 18th, and at that point we run into a conflict with the range reconfiguration for the Delta IV GPS launch that's scheduled for May 20th. To summarize, the countdown is proceeding very well, and we're not tracking any issues. The hard work and dedication of everyone involved with STS-132 has gotten us to this point, and all our systems are go to proceed with the work that remains in launch countdown, and we're looking forward to a spectacular launch tomorrow afternoon at 2:20. Thanks.
Thank you. Robbie.
Okay, good morning. Let's see, I'll start with a quick status on the payloads, and then we have a little bit of video that we'll run through. Let's see, for the payloads, this is actually one of the more enjoyable parts of the flow for us. Our payloads have been installed in the payload bay and are safely tucked away. The payload bay doors were closed this past Tuesday. So the primary payloads, the MRM-1 module, the Russian module, and the ICC carrier have been in there with the doors closed. The only other activity that we have to go is the loading of the research, the late stow experiments, and our team is just about right now preparing to go and take receipt of those late stow experiments from the research teams, and then get those out to the pad and turn them over for installation into the crew compartment mid deck, and those should be installed by later this afternoon. So. Payloads, we're not working any issues. It's been a very good final flow at the pad. We get to, at this point, now that the payload bay doors are closed, kind of exhale and relax a little and watch the launch team do their thing. And we look forward to tomorrow's launch, and weather is still looking good. We're excited for our Russian partners who have been here. The Energia team have been here since December with their module, getting it ready to go. And so we're excited for them that that we're here at the eve of launching their module to the station. And it will be, not only is it the first Russian module to be launched or flown to station on the shuttle, it will be the last also, so a first and a last. So we're looking forward to that. There's the mission itself is going to be very exciting. There's three EVAs activities, as well as a lot of robotics operations, including the installation of the MRM-1 module on the station. That's on flight day 5. So we sit back, relax a little today, get the payload experiments loaded, and then be out here tomorrow for the launch, and then get to watch things as they unfold on orbit. Let's see, that's it for status. If we could, I believe we've got a short video that I'll walk through. Okay, this is back in December out at the shuttle landing facility, and that's the Antonov 124 heavy lift cargo aircraft bringing the MRM-1 module from Moscow here to the United States. This was on December 17th. You're looking at the transportation container being offloaded, gets transferred to a flatbed, and then from there was taken off-center and over to Astrotech at the port for their final launch site preparations. There you see technicians, or as the Russians call them, specialists, loading cargo into the module, and now they're preparing the module to for hatch closure. It is launching 1,400 kilograms, or just over 3,000 pounds of U.S. cargo inside the module. And now they are closing the hatch. And this is just days before bringing it back on center to the space station processing facility. These red covers are protective covers that get removed just before going into our payload canister. And now they are preparing it for shipment. They're on air-bearing casters right now, taking it over to where it will be loaded into its shipping container. These are actually Astrotech technicians loading the module into the shipping container. So they set it on this blue cradle, and the container cover gets installed over the top. Now we're in the space station processing facility, looking at the module being installed into the our payload canister. You can see the red protective covers had been removed. That's the one of the grapple fixtures. That's the one the space station arm will take the handoff from the shuttle's arm during the mating operations. And this is the integrated cargo carrier 2 days later on April 7th being loaded into the payload canister. You're looking at the six batteries that will be installed on the P6, and you see the KU band antenna on the front of the carrier. Now our payload canister is being rotated from horizontal to vertical just before going out to the pad. So we take it, rotate it to vertical, and set it back down on the same transporter. Now it's vertical and ready for the trip to the pad. And this is April 15th in the evening, on the way out to the launch pad, passing the VAB and the launch control center in the background. Now we're back in the space station processing facility downstairs in our offline laboratories as the some of the research teams are doing their final preparations of their experiments for this flight. What you're looking at there is actually sterilization of rice seeds being prepared for the JAXA's called a ferulate experiment. And then these are some of the rice seeds that are will be flown up. And this particular experiment is it's called fish scales, and there's more information in the press kit, but these are scales that are harvested from goldfish, and we're studying basically these are regenerative scales, and they'll be studying looking at bone loss and atrophy. Now we are back to this week earlier on the 11th with the final closing of the payload bay doors. And this is for the payload team again. This is at the moment where we kind of let out a big exhale and can relax a little and turn our sights to launch day. So the doors are closed, and I'd like to echo what Jeremy said in complimenting the various teams in getting not only the shuttle but the payloads ready for this flight. It was a challenging flow for the shuttle team, right on the heels of the STS-131, and getting the pad turned around, and then the orbiter out there. It's been a lot of activity here in the last 2-3 weeks, but the orbiter team, shuttle team, has done a fantastic job in taking care of us as well, getting our payloads installed, and we're just excited for the launch tomorrow.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Todd?
Good morning. I do have some good weather, good news as far as the weather is concerned. We've had high pressure over us for the past few days, and that high pressure has stayed firm, and we're expecting that to stay over the top of Florida at least until Sunday. If we take a look at the satellite picture, you can see virtually cloud-free skies over Florida. And along the coast, there are some low clouds out over the water, and they are moving onshore. And most of the nasty weather is well out to our north and west with that real strong high-pressure system over the top of us. It's going to remain well to our north and west throughout the count, and even Saturday and Sunday if we would happen to need those days. As far as the next 24 hours, we're looking for that high pressure center to actually be to our north. That's going to move some of those clouds that are offshore, onshore. So we'll see brief periods of partly cloudy skies, easterly winds, and overall pretty dry conditions. As far as a tanking forecast tomorrow, we will be looking at those scattered skies. We may have a brief isolated shower right along the coast kind of move through. But overall, light easterly winds, scattered skies, and pretty dry conditions for tanking operations. We're not looking at any constraints or any constraints to be violated by weather conditions at all. As far as the launch for tomorrow afternoon, we're looking for those scattered skies once again. Winds will be out of the east, peaking at 18 knots. One thing I am a little concerned with and I'm watching is if we get some additional low-level convergence, we could see some of those areas of clouds be fairly large. And if there's some larger low clouds kind of move into our area like yesterday afternoon, we could see a low cloud ceiling. So because of those low cloud ceilings, I'm looking at a 30% chance of weather prohibiting launch here at KSC. As far as SRB recovery operations, the area is going to be looking pretty nice out there also. Scattered skies right underneath that high pressure system. Winds are going to be more out of the southeast, rather light. And sea state's only 3 to 4 feet, so good weather conditions for that operation also. As far as CONUS operations for abort landing site, the Space Flight Meteorology Group is forecasting clear skies out at Edwards and scattered skies out at White Sands, and winds will be out of the southwest at both locations, rather light. As far as the overseas landing sites, SMG is forecasting broken skies at 5,000 feet at Zaragoza and a chance of showers within 20 nautical miles, and showers at Istres also within 20 nautical miles. However, Marone looking good with broken skies at 7,000 feet and light winds, so Marone looking good for tomorrow afternoon. As far as a 24-hour slip forecast, we're still looking for that high-pressure system to bring in some low clouds into our area, so scattered skies at 3,000 feet. And we're also looking at that same weather pattern. So we could still see some larger areas of clouds move in, giving us a brief ceiling. And because of that, the probability of weather prohibiting launch here at KSC is at 30% for that day also. The CONUS sites are also looking good. Few at 25,000 feet and few clouds are at Edwards and a few clouds at White Sands. Overall, no problems with the weather conditions at either one of those sites. As far as our TAL sites overseas, still looking for showers in the area at Zaragoza and a ceiling at 4,000 feet. And we're also looking at winds strengthening up at Istres. However, Marone still looks good for Saturday operations. In the event of a 48-hour slip, we're going to see the upper level ridge start to break down a little bit on Sunday. And with that, we'll see some more clouds coming in at the higher levels. And we'll still see low level winds out of the east. So with those two conditions, we're looking for scattered skies at 3,000, broken skies at 25,000, and overall pretty nice conditions on Sunday. As far as the CONUS of MORT sites, still looking for good conditions at both locations. And as far as the overseas site, Zaragoza and Morón both look good. We will still have some gusty surface winds at Istres causing problems with the headwinds. So overall, we're looking at really good conditions for launch operations. That high pressure system has been very friendly to us and bringing us real nice conditions for the month of May. And right now we're looking at a 30% chance of KSC violating weather constraints both Friday, Saturday, and even Sunday. Kendria.
Thank you. We'll now take questions. When the microphone comes your way, please state your name, affiliation, and to whom you're addressing your question. I'll start with Chris.
Chris Gebhardt with NASAspaceflight.com, with one for Jeremy and one for Robbie. For Jeremy, what is the current launch time tomorrow down to the second that you have for the latest opportunity?
Right now I'm tracking 2:20 and 8 seconds.
And for Robbie, in terms of the late stow experiments that are going on today, can you talk a little bit about what some of those are and what type of turnaround time you have on that should we find ourselves in a scrub turnaround situation?
Sure. Let's see. There's several of the experiments are JAXA-sponsored experiments. The one or two actually that I mentioned during the video, the fish scales and the ferrolate experiment. Ferrolate is studying basically the effects of microgravity space flight on the cellular wall structure of these, in this case, the rice seeds. But they also have a third, the hydrotropy experiment that's looking at using a moisture gradient as a control mechanism for plant growth on orbit or in a microgravity environment where you have a lack of gravity. And generally, plants on Earth, their root structure grows towards gravity. Without that, it kind of tends to go in all different directions. And they're trying to control that, so they're looking at using moisture gradient as a control mechanism for that. So in addition to the JAXA experiments, and all of those will be transferred over and conducted in their experiment laboratory on orbit. There's a couple of National Lab Pathfinder experiments. One is a cells experiment, just looking at replication of cells in the microgravity environment, trying to improve techniques. And the other is one of a series of the vaccine experiments, looking at basically at pathogens and developing vaccines for various pathogens. This is the ninth, I believe, in that series of experiments to be flown. In addition, there's a lot of science that's going up, and as well, we're actually, in addition to the ones we're taking up, some of it stays, some of it goes up and comes back, a sortie flight, and then there's also a lot of science that we're bringing home that's been up there and undergoing you know, research experiments, actually some of it since last November. So it's, even though we don't have a one of the logistics modules that typically brings a lot of science with it, there is a lot of science on this flight going up and coming back. And I have more details I could provide you, or there's more in the press kit as well.
Marcia.
I'm sorry, I just want to, the final launch T0, we'll come up with that at the T-minus 9-minute hold, and we'll get that out to everybody. Sorry.
Thank you. Marcia.
Marcia Dunn, Associated Press. First for Mr. Ashley, do you have a number of Russians in town for the launch? Do you know estimated how many are here?
Well, total I do not know. We've primarily been working with the Energia team that was responsible for the MRM-1 module itself. So about right now there's probably about 30 or so roughly of the Energia team. This is much smaller than the numbers obviously when they were actively preparing their module, but I don't have a good number in terms of other, like Roscosmos, Russian Space Agency visitors, but I know that there will be, you know, another fairly large contingent of Roscosmos visitors as well, obviously for the launching of their module.
Thank you, and for Mr. Graber, would you anticipate trying if all things are equal and you don't get off tomorrow, would you probably just do two, stand down and do two more, or could you conceive doing three in a row, or what's your going in ideas?
Again, the launch director has that prerogative to look at the day of launch conditions. If we were to have that 24-hour scrub turnaround and we had to go into another scrub, we would talk about it. There are several factors that play into that decision, but we're going to do the smart thing. We'll look at the crew rest for the folks on console. We'll look at all those different factors and make an assessment and then decide from that point on. But our baseline plan would be to do a 24-hour scrub turnaround followed by a 48-hour scrub turnaround.
Robert.
Hi, Robert Perlman with collectspace.com with a question for Robbie. In regards to this being the first and, I guess, last Russian module, can you explain why it differs from the Proda docking module that was launched in 1995 to Mir that was also Energia built on the shuttle? Thanks.
Well, that of course, was another Russian module, but that one, as you mentioned, destined for the Mir space station. So when I say the first and the last, I meant the first and the last launched on the shuttle to the International Space Station.
Clara.
Clara Moskowitz with space.com, and this is also for Mr. Ashley. You mentioned the 1,400 kilograms of U.S. cargo. Could you just give a little bit more idea of what that cargo is?
Sure, it's a mixed bag, so to speak, but there's a lot of it is crew provisions, food, other crew supplies. There are some of it is station hardware. There's some replacement parts for some of the components on orbit, including the Sabatier that was launched on STS-131. There's some spares for it, and there's lithium hydroxide, oxygen canisters. It's a mixed bag. There's several laptop computers that are going up. I can give you further details afterwards.
Ken.
For Robbie, pretty much to follow up on that question, Mike Moses said that this module was pretty packed. Are these can you describe that, how packed it is, and are these components on the inside the shuttle bags, and are there any science experiments also on MRM-1?
Okay, so the first part of that, as far as how packed, it is very tightly packed. One of the things they will have to do before they're able to use the module for its primary mission is to unload all of the cargo. There's just not enough room to work in there with the bags installed. So there are bags installed on around either side, port and starboard, as well as down what we call the center aisle. So it is very tightly packed in the module. And as far as experiments flying on it, there's no experiment samples or anything, but there is some experiment hardware that is being taken up inside the module to support some of the experiments that are up there now, as well as some of the supporting hardware for the National Lab Pathfinders that are flying up on this mission. Did I get all parts of your question? Or sure.
James.
Thanks, James. Dean from Florida today for either Jeremy or Robbie. Just wondered if you could comment on the significance of this flight, not just from an Atlantis perspective, but on the capability that you're going to be adding to space station with only a few more flights before you can call the U.S. segment at least assembly complete.
I'm going to start with Atlantis and then I'll...
Sure. Every space shuttle flight is an amazing feat. There's a huge number of people that are involved and put a whole lot of hard work and heart and effort into it. So each one of these is an amazing feat, and we, care about each one exactly the same. And, we're happy to have Atlantis be ready to go, and the teams are all ready to go.
And as far as significance for the payloads and what that will bring to the station, of course, the primary payload and the primary objective is the launching of the MRM-1. And it's a mini research module. So after all of the cargo that's inside is removed, they will transfer some experiment racks, workstations into it, and so it will be able to perform science in these workstations, as well as the module. Once docked to the station, it's docked to the Zarya or FGB module, so it'll be taking a permanent residence there on that docking port, but its aft end will also serve as a replacement or the fourth docking port on the Russian segment. So future Soyuz and Progress vehicles will be able to dock there as one of the four Russian segment ports. And then also, I haven't talked a whole lot about it, but kind of riding up piggyback on the MRM-1 are several of the outfitting components for a later Russian module, the multipurpose laboratory module, MLM, which I believe is scheduled to be launched in the fall of 2012, although don't hold me to that. But there's the equipment airlock that's prominently featured there on the back of the MRM-1. So this airlock will be used for transferring equipment from inside to out. It also has the radiator, which will be used for cooling of the MLM module. And there's a spare elbow for the European or ESA robotic arm that is also mounted and going up. So that will, like I said, it's a spare, but so if needed, it'll be used for the ESA robot arm in doing the transfer of these items from the MRM-1 over to the MLM once it arrives, as well as future robotic activities. And then there is a portable workstation for crew member, EVA crew, that's flown on the exterior and will be available for supporting Russian EVAs in the future.
Thanks. And for Todd, just wondered if, with this possible low cloud cover that could develop, is that something you're likely to see coming well before launch time, or is it something that would happen kind of quickly and you just have to kind of get lucky in that 10-minute window?
For the most part, we're going to be able to see those clouds coming. They're going to be out offshore, and we'll be watching on satellite, and we'll have observers stationed in different areas watching for the clouds to come in. So we'll be able to see on satellite those move in and verify that they're moving in with our ground observations. But we'll be able to see them tomorrow morning. As soon as we get that visible satellite picture, we'll start to see those clouds and see where they're at.
Irene Klotz with Reuters. On the clouds, is that a TAL issue, or is that also for visibility for range safety?
That's a range safety issue. The range is required to be able to see the vehicle take off and also go through the clouds and come out the top of the clouds. So that's why we have those range safety requirements.
Okay, and over here in the front row, please.
Peter Aylward, Southern FM in Australia. A question for Mr. Graber. On the last mission, Discovery, there was a fairly large piece of tile liberated from the tail section. And I just wondered if there was a reason for that. Was it a debris strike or a failure of the attachment? And if there's any actions following that?
Well, for Atlantis, we've gone and inspected all of those similar tiles and feel that we've done everything we can to look at those and understand that they're in good shape. There are no issues with those tiles whatsoever. They're continuing to look at the Discovery's tiles and try and understand exactly what happened. There have been, the right folks have gotten together. Several teams have been put together to go look at that. They've looked at it from many different angles, and some of that data is still in work, but there's no issue with Atlantis's tiles, and Atlantis is ready to go.
And a question for Mr. Ashley. I believe there was an issue a little while ago identified on the MRM-1 module where some paint was flaking off. Was that resolved, an issue or something done there to address that?
Yes, it has been resolved, and it's the thermal protective coating on the radiator. That there were some flakes that were found liberated after we transferred out to the launch pad, rotated to vertical, and got out to the launch pad. And during our transfer operations, some of these flakes were noted. Of course, you know, pulled together the technical communities, both on the Russian side and our side, to talk about it. This coating is very similar, almost identical to the thermal coating that we use on our U.S.-built radiators. So we're very familiar with the material properties of it. And basically, in summary, the assessment was that this was this liberation was in local, very small percentage of the area, less than 0.2% of where it was being liberated from. It is coming from an area that had undergone some repair or touch-up work at the Astrotech facility, and it's a very this material. It's very difficult to do repairs, and so that's the thoughts there were that it just had become debonded in this small repair area. But the overall assessment is that it's not an issue from a thermal perspective, and all of the delaminated material has been removed, so it's all ready to go.
No further questions? Well, that will conclude the L-1 countdown status briefing. As Jeremy mentioned, the rotating service structure will be moved away from Space Shuttle Atlantis tonight at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time. That will be shown on NASA television. Please join us tomorrow morning for live launch coverage that will begin at 4:45 a.m. with tanking commentary. For more information on the STS-132 mission and crew, visit www.nasa.gov/shuttle. Thank you.